Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning time. Good to have you all with us in person here at noon on Wednesday and online on Sunday morning. And as we find ways to connect across the internet and across time, those are also, there's people 8:30 and 11 right here in the same room on Sunday morning celebrating World Communion Sunday, first Sunday in October, World Communion Sunday. I laugh because when I was a kid, it was still Worldwide Communion Sunday. And we get rid of wide, and it's called World Communion Sunday now. But everybody that's a part of the World Council of Churches is taking communion this morning, and it's an understanding that we're all connected across denominations, across time, across the world, even as we do this across the internet. What a wonderful time to be alive that we can do that. And I hope that you have with you your cup and your juice. We're not ready to take them out yet. Maybe you have some at home, and that would be great too. Announcements. It is the first Sunday, and there will be a box for North Strand Helping Hand for canned food, for milk, for the dried milk and things like that. So that will be out front for North Strand Helping Hand, the box that we received for them. Other than that, I don't think there are any other announcements that I need to make. And so we're going to jump right into our first hymn, which is For the Healing of the Nations. It's hymn 428. And we're singing the first three verses of For the Healing of the Nations. Let us sing. Sunday morning, due to the COVID restrictions that we have in place, people spend most of this time in the, at the communion table and in the communion liturgy. And so as not to rush it, we're going to try to take our time through this, knowing that we do have that brief span of time. But we're going to take a deep breath and enjoy hearing these ancient words that have been passed down to us. I am using the liturgy from the communion service of Word and Table 4, which is the old communion service, going way back, EUB stuff, again, the old hymnal that I remember as a kid. And when I remember taking communion, these are the words I remember from a child. I'm using them. So often now when we do communion, it is kind of added on, tacked on, and kind of rushed at the end of the service sometimes. And so we don't normally do service of Word and Table 4 because it's a little bit longer. We're going to spend some time with it today. And I'll just walk you through it since most of you don't have the responses. If you do, that's great. But every communion has an invitation. And the invitation is this: ye that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take his holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Invitation followed by confession. And generally we do it all together, because we don't have all the responses out there, I will read this confession and you can pray it along with me, and we can do it that way. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, deed, against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Invitation, confession, pardon. And the pardon I offer is not my pardon to you or your pardon to me. It's Jesus Christ pardoned for us. And we pray this. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all that with hearty repentance and true faith turn to thee, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then in that same service it says, words of assurance, and they have lots of passages of scripture listed out that you would know that the communion words. I'm going to jump right into the scripture lessons we've been reading from John's gospel. I have said this before and I'll say it again. One of the interesting things about John's gospel, I believe you can read the entirety of John's gospel as a commentary on the Last Supper. If you just put it all in the context, it's not the only way to read it, and that's not the only intention of it, but it really works well as when we read through John's Gospel, thinking about Jesus' time at the Last Supper, which is interesting because John's Gospel does not talk about the Last Supper in the sense that they don't serve communion in John's Gospel. So what's missing is what they're talking about in some ways. And I think it really fits well for today, and for all that we're doing as we read through John, it's a commentary on the Last Supper, which makes it a commentary on communion. When we do communion, when we read John, we can think about it in those terms. In today's passage of Scripture, John 11 fits right in with that. John chapter 11, verses 1 through 4 reads like this. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and his sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sister sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, the illness is not unto death, it is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by means of the Word of God to the people of God. Thanks be to God. So in John's Gospel, and these passage of Scripture in John chapter 11, we hear the beginning verses of what we know as the story about the raising of Lazarus from the dead. Lazarus was sick. Mary and Martha sent for Jesus. And in John chapter 11, we start to understand more deeply that Jesus has come to be the giver of life. This story starts to really pick up on that. Jesus is the one who gives life. But it also is interesting in John chapter 11, he's the giver of life, but Jesus is in no hurry in this story. It's confounding sometimes for us that Jesus doesn't move quickly enough for us. When we're ready for something, we want it now. We're used to that kind of immediacy in everything we do. Jesus' action is not hurried in John chapter 11, and Jesus' actions aren't always hurried in my life, much to my chagrin. I would much happier if it was. My prayer is almost always this. My prayer for human is almost always this. Lord, make it quick, make it complete. That's my prayer to Jesus. And I'm not afraid to do that. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not embarrassed by that. Lord, make it quick and make it complete. Jesus' response is almost always what it says in John chapter 11. Jesus' response, your healing is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified. I'm saying make it quick, make it complete. He's saying, you'll be healed, and it'll be for God's glory, and for that I might be glorified. And then my response is always, because I know that it's not moving quickly enough for me, kind of like Mary and Martha, my response is, Lord, whom thou lovest is ill. Whom thou lovest is sick. Lord, I'm sick, and I need help now. And Jesus' response again, right here in John chapter 11, if you read through the rest of it, I'll be there soon enough. It says in John chapter 11, he stayed 2 days longer when he heard about this. 2 days longer! Reminded of one of my faculty advisors in seminary, Dr. Noel Erskine from Jamaica, and talking about this passage of Scripture, I can still hear his words echoing in my head in his Jamaican accent. I will not do a Jamaican accent because I would do it wrong and I would offend a lot of people in my ignorance of doing that. But I can hear him saying, I'll soon come. I'll soon come. Jesus will soon come. He'll soon come for Lazarus. He'll soon come for us. Maybe not as quickly as we want, not on our time frame. And that healing will be complete, and we will find ourselves raised from the death that we have in our lives to a new life. But the question remains for us, what are we to do? What are we to do? What are Mary and Martha to do? What are we to do at this church right now? What are we to do as a people? Whom thou lovest is sick, Lord. My friend is sick. My lover is sick. My spouse is sick. My child is sick. We're sick, Lord. Please come. If that's not enough, our country is sick. Our system is sick. Our politicians are sick. Lord, please come. Our communities and our churches are sick. Lord, please come. This is our cry, Lord, whom thou lovest is sick. What are we to do? And today on World Communion Sunday, we are reminded that one thing we can do is stop and pause. Come to the table together. And know that not only will the Lord come to be with us, but the Lord is already present with us at this table. That he's not abandoning us. And it may not be on our timeline, but Jesus is telling us to get together. Come together as God's people. Come together at this table. And come together at this table, and again on World Communion Sunday, for years I've preached and practiced that we're all taking this communion together. Across denominations, across time, across the world. When we're doing this with limited seating, with internet access, we're doing it on Wednesdays and Sundays and at different points during the week. I believe we're doing it now more than ever the way it was meant to be had. That we're crossing all of those divisions of time and space and day, and we're coming to this table together. That's what we're to do. Lord, whom thou lovest is sick, and Jesus says, I'll be there in a couple days, but while I'm on my way. You people need to get together. And you need to sit down. And you need to remember what I will do for you, what I have done for you, and what I am doing for you. And that's what communion reminds us of this morning. Jesus said, I'll soon come. Jesus does come. And Jesus does complete his promise. And Jesus does give us what we need. He is the giver of life. And just because my prayer isn't answered when I want it to be answered, doesn't mean that he's not coming and that all that we're going through, personally, corporately, throughout the world, all that we're going through is certainly going to be used for God's glory, for the building of his kingdom, so that Jesus Christ may be glorified. Today we pause to come together at the table to be reminded that Jesus will not only come, but he's already here in our midst. Right here, body and blood in our midst. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We got invitation. We got confession. We got prayer and pardon. We got words of assurance. Then it says the taking of the bread and the cup. The taking of the bread and the cup. And we say words over the taking of the bread and the cup that are familiar. This week, this Sunday, this day, they'll be said in different languages, different liturgies around the world, across denominations. But they will all say similar things. And we'll come to the table and we'll say, the Lord be with you. And you will respond, and with thy spirit. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
And with thy spirit. Lift up your hearts. And you say, we lift them up to the Lord.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord. And you say, it is meet and right to do so.
It is meet and right to do so.
And I say, it is very right and our bounden duty that we should at all times and at all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God. And therefore, with the angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious names evermore, praising thee and singing, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory to be to thee, O Lord most high. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. And we shout together, Hosanna in the highest. Say it, Hosanna in the highest. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by the one offering of himself a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, and didst institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and bless and sanctify with thy word and thy spirit these gifts of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his passion, death, and resurrection, may be partakers of the divine nature through him. Who in the same night he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you, do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after the supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks and gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And then we pray. O Lord, our heavenly Father, we, thy humble servants, desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we may and thy whole church may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passions. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. And although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, Yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom in the whole in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And again, we come to receive the communion. A little cup in the cup right here. Cup right here. As you came in, you were given these little cups, these little breads. And we say these words as we take the body and blood of Christ, and the words of institution are simply this. This is the body. And this is the blood of Jesus Christ given for you. And I pray this old prayer. Lord, we do not presume to come to this thy table trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord, whose property is to always have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, to partake of this sacrament of thy Son, Jesus Christ, that we may walk in the newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in him, and he and us, the body and blood of Christ, given for you. Get a little piece off the top. Take the wafer. You can do it one of two ways. You can take the wafer and you can dip it in the blood of Christ, or you can drink it. Body and blood of Christ, given for you. Yes, an awkward way to receive communion, but a fitting and right way, very meet, as we said, way to do it, as we share in this table across time, across hours, across denomination. Again, let us pray. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning and good afternoon, friends. A couple of announcements to follow up with what Pastor Russell shared earlier. One is that we are still recruiting and in need of trunks for our drive-through trunk retreat. We'll be announcing that for the next several weeks, and so if you are interested in participating, please look to our online resources for ways to sign up and register or call the church office, and we can get you connected that way. Another announcement is that we have made a transition in our contemporary worship space to allow for a space for families to come and to feel a little more comfortable with younger children in the midst of pandemic, to be able to play and worship together simultaneously. And it was brought to our attention in our visioning and processing plan for where the Holy Spirit is leading us this past week during our discussion that our traditional service is also in need of that same welcoming presence and experience for our families who are indeed returning to worship with us. And so beginning this Sunday, we will have a space in our balcony, friends who are worshiping online with us, when you become comfortable coming back with your family, for you as a family to come and worship and have some joyful noise space as well. For we know that it is truly the voice of God among us when we hear the cries, the cheers, and the joyful noise of children's voices. And so our space in our balcony will be reserved for our families with children on one side of the balcony. And it will have some quieter toys, some soft places for floor play, and some areas where children and families can be comfortable worshiping and continuing to be a part of our community in this sacred place. Very excited for that transition. So friends, now as we continue offering thanks for the blessings that God has bestowed upon us, let us give thanks to God in prayer for the gifting of our offerings. Lord, we ask that you would humbly bless this offering, our gifts, our tithes, that you would continue to use them for your will in your world, throughout it, today, and always. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. who is our wholeness, the one who calls us into the light of Christ as whole and healed and fulfilled people. We seek that wholeness today. We are restored by the receiving of your bread, your juice. We know it is you that is within us, helping us to continue forward, not only here in our congregation, but throughout your world. And Lord, as we seek to continue as your people to grow among one another as your disciples, we ask that you would weave us together, creating the beauty of the diversity of the fabric that is humanity. Help us to be your people on this journey, reflective of your light and your grace abundant this day. Help to guide and lead us just as you have continued to guide and lead those who you taught to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, I invite you to raise your hands in the receiving of our benediction. May you know that you are indeed whole creations of the divine Creator who has given his life for us. Go in peace this day.